So Celise Chilcote is going to be speaking on behalf of herself and Sabrina Agarwal and Menno Hoogland, who is actually from Leiden. And this is all taking place, I guess, in the Netherlands. And it is about some of her work of her dissertation, obviously with her colleagues, and it's called a multivariate approach to activity pattern analysis. The case, sounds like a mystery story, the case of Middenbeemster, Netherlands. So, thank you, Celise.
So this presentation is actually on the initial three quarters of my dissertation project, which aims at examining aspects of social identity in the post-medieval population of skeletons from the cemetery of Middenbeemster in the Netherlands. Trying to do this through the examination of skeletal markers of bone growth and maintenance and activity-related stress. So, the town of Middenbeemster was an extremely important dairy farming community in North Holland, and what I'm hoping is that a bioarchaeological study of its community will provide a great deal of information on not only the daily lives of the inhabitants, but will also shed light on the development of the dairy peasantry on the coastal provinces of the Netherlands. So, the social construction of identity does not revolve around any one concept, but is intricately informed by gender, social status, class, ethnicity, and age. So what is significant is how the body represents a contextually dependent materiality that, through the incorporation of the life course perspective and biocultural analyses, can eliminate information about not only the connection between an individual and the different stages of their life and identity, but can also reveal how they were situated within the context of the larger society in which they existed. The challenge at this point is that social constructions are unique to every culture and time period, and can be difficult to elucidate without historical documentation on the culture and time period in question. So here enters bioarchaeology. Since physiological changes in skeletons can correspond to alterations in sociocultural identity, if remains are analyzed in social context, cultural comparisons can be made. Bioarchaeologists can also identify biocultural events that may be particularly culturally or socially important. For example, by identifying the time of weaning or puberty, bioarchaeologists may be able to also identify and define socially defined age grades. This focus on culturally contextualizing human remains is what has been termed the biocultural approach, which is ultimately the interest in reconstructing the biological footings of the skeletal body and cultural framework that have together created the social spaces and social creatures that inhabit them. Biocultural analyses offer a unique perspective in the examination of such a complex and dynamic system by being positioned to not only consider the biological agents, but also their interactions with nature, culture, and one another. Therefore, by acknowledging the dynamic and complex factors inherent in the human body, incorporation of life course theory and the biocultural approach allow anthropologists to study the ontogeny and life histories of individuals and groups via contextualization that equally incorporates biologically and culturally influencing factors in order to better inform on past cultural frameworks. The Netherlands. They're lovely. The complex history of the Netherlands has shaped and reshaped not only the country's social, political, and economic face, but also its physical landscape. The extremely variable geography and soils throughout the Netherlands, combined with the effects of what was known as the Little Ice Age, that happened from 1300 to 1850, presented numerous difficulties for any sort of intensification of agriculture. In the provinces of Holland specifically, especially in northern Holland, the challenge was to occupy the extensive peat bogs. were both a blessing because they provided a very cheap source of fuel. They were also an impediment to any sort of arable farming or animal husbandry because they were so soggy. This part of the Netherlands is literally below sea level. So any sort of arable land is at a premium. So, windmills. During the 14th and 15th centuries, there was what was known as a low technology agricultural revolution, which involved the implementation of lay farming to reduce fallow land and the introduction of windmills for actually draining and pumping water away from fields. Between 1610 and 1640, intense lake drainage and land reclamation was accomplished through the introduction of ring canals, which, if you look carefully, you can kind of see that what looks like city streets to us in concentric rings are actually all canals. So by taking water away and forming dikes, they were actually able to reclaim land that they could build and farm upon. Ring canals are also known as polders. And these use turnable windmills to drain an area. So by around 1650, Holland's farmland had increased by a third, and a large new class of farmers had emerged. Despite the success of these innovations and alterations, much of the soil of North Holland was still unsuitable for arable farming, and instead the occupants focused on cattle and dairy farming, cultivating nitrogen-rich clover to feed the animals as well as enrich the soil. These changes allowed for a commercial orientation to agriculture to develop in the Netherlands. And this actually fed the demands of the growing city of Amsterdam, which was also home to the numerous trading ships of the Dutch East India Company, which had been established in 1602 and went widely throughout the world. So, agriculture became the largest sector in the Dutch economy, but was heavily impacted both positively and negatively during the 30 Years' War, the War of Spanish Succession, the Fourth English-Dutch War, the French Revolution, and finally the Napoleonic Wars. So as you can see, essentially, from 1618 to 1815, which are relevant to the collection I'm going to be looking at, there was a series of political strife. Despite the significant hardships that the shifting political climate had on the arable farming areas of the Netherlands, the specialized dairy farming areas remained mostly unaffected due to the irreplaceable demand for their exports. Towards the end of the 18th century, England became Europe's largest food importer and was supplied heavily from the nearby Netherlands. By the beginning of the 19th century, 20% of Dutch dairy products alone were being exported. Middenbeemster. The small town of Middenbeemster is located in the modern municipality of Beemster in the province of North Holland, 10 kilometers from the western coast of Lake Markermeer and 20 kilometers to the east of the North Sea. So very, very close to bodies of water, really below sea level. The Beemster Polder was completed in 1612 during the intense land reclamation previously mentioned. And despite the unstable political climate and economic climate of the 17th and 18th centuries for much of the North Sea area, Beemster became and has remained one of the largest dairy farming villages in Holland. It is internationally famous still for its namesake Beemster cheese. Just for a note kind of on the general geographical location, Beemster is very close to Gouda, or Gouda, as they will tell you, if much. So, during the summer of 2011, the cemetery used by the colonizing farming community of the Beemster Polder from 1617 to 1866 was excavated as part of a joint rescue project by Hollandia Archaeologen and the Laboratory for Human Osteoarchaeology at Leiden University. More than 500 individuals were recovered representing all ages and many in excellent preservation. The majority of the graves are from the 19th century and were carefully laid out and numbered with historical records of the individuals interred there, with information sometimes including name, sex, age, occasionally occupation, family relations, or even nationality if they had immigrated. So the Middenbeemster skeletal sample provides the unique opportunity to examine age and gender-related divisions of activity and labor during this changing and challenging historical period. Further, the variety of historical documentation about Dutch culture, as well as the historical documentation on this specific cemetery and the individuals interred there, make this uniquely poised to inform questions about rural Dutch society, as well as the development of social identities over the life course during the 18th and 19th centuries in Northern Holland. Information about individuals, subgroups, and entire populations can be derived through a variety of both micro and macroscopic bioarchaeological analyses. The potential of skeletal biology to provide a wealth of information previously considered unattainable has become increasingly important to the field of archaeology, since many aspects of past lifeways leave no material evidence in the archaeological record. Bioarchaeologists specifically integrate knowledge of skeletal biology with archaeological and historical context to approach anthropological questions. It is actually only recently that there has been a movement away from a focus on descriptive and typological categorizations of skeletal variation and towards an emphasis on context and the complementary nature of biological and cultural approaches. Specifically, we are trying to interpret behavior from the human skeleton in order to reconstruct past social situations. While bioarchaeological analyses can contribute to the formation of inferences about behavioral activity patterns of past populations via the examination of gross morphological changes of the skeleton, advancements during the last two decades in research on skeletal variations have linked variability in morphology to the reconstruction of general patterns of activity, including the potential for inferring sociocultural implications. In general, specific activities are less likely to be recognized than the organization of general patterns of activities and levels of stress associated with them. However, both individual and population level differences can be identified through the analysis of morphological variability, which may eliminate facets of social organization, such as sex and age-based divisions of labor, or the presence of distinct subgroups. Intra-population changes over time can also be examined and may suggest changes in activity patterns. While interpopulation comparisons can be used to help clarify the role of environment on activities as reflected in morphological variability. Bone in a living individual is actually a living tissue, just like your skin, muscles, or organs. This means that over the course of your life, your bones are constantly reacting to a variety of influences. Nutrition, disease, exercise, stress, even disuse. So some of these influences may not be strong enough or happen repetitively enough to actually leave a significant mark on your skeleton, while others may be so dramatic that they will permanently affect a bone, such as a terrible break that's not properly treated. This is referred to as the concept of dynamic plasticity, which is the anatomical ability of bone to adapt to environmental changes, both physiological and behavioral, during life through permanent morphological alteration. Thus, for bone, form reflects function. So clinical and osteological studies have provided evidence that skeletal morphology, patterns of non-pathological osteoarthritis, characteristics of the size and robusticity of muscle insertion sites, also known as entheseal changes or ECs, cross-sectional geometry of long bones, and the presence degree of expression of a variety of non-genetic, non-metric traits. So for example, these would be expansion of an articular surface area or facet that's linked to squatting. These in turn can be correlated with general patterns of activity. So these four main categories of skeletal activity pattern analyses that employ a form reflex function premise are biomechanics, musculoskeletal insertion studies, or entheseal changes, non-pathological osteoarthritis, and non-genetic non-metric traits. A whole body life course approach, which combines a variety of activity pattern analyses, provides the strongest support for activity-related morphological variations and their development during life. In the study of the historic Middenbeemster population, all four of these activity pattern analyses were employed. However, I will only be discussing the last three of these in this presentation. Entheses are the rugged attachment areas where muscles insert into bone. The development and degree of expression of these bony manifestations has been linked to forceful and repetitive activities involving specific groups of muscles. So essentially, the more you use a group of muscles, the bigger they get, and therefore so does their attachment area on bone. Protocols for scoring robusticity of entheseal changes are insertion site specific and range from one slight, which you can see on the left, to three severe. This, for example, is the three grades of the brachialis insertion, which is right here on your arm. In addition to examining the robusticity of entheseal insertions, I also recorded the degree, if present, of stress lesions, which include pitting and furrowing of an attachment area, which appear to be associated with continuous microtrauma. There's also the category of ossification exostoses, which essentially are bony projections that form when an abrupt macrotrauma, such as a muscle rupture, causes new bone formation to be incorporated into tendon or ligament tissue. In addition to demonstrating relatively generalized activity patterns, analyses of entheseal changes, analyses of entheseal changes have been successfully used to identify group level differences in activities, such as divisions of labor based on sex and age, or both of these things, degrees of task specialization, such as food processing techniques, even effects of the physical environment, such as differences in terrain on locomotory behaviors. Research into osteoarthritis has found that changes related to biomechanical stress versus the effects of age, genetics, ancestry, nutrition, etc., are most likely to appear on appendicular joint surfaces, so joints of your appendages. Therefore, I followed a standard ordinal scoring methodology for the three categories of subchondral porosity, which would be all of the porous nature that you can see on this joint surface. Lipping, when you get bony growths at the margins of joint surfaces. Or eburnation, which happens when you have complete dissolution of articular cartilage and just bone on bone rubbing against each other, which creates a polished, shiny, grooved surface. Probably exceedingly painful. Non-metric traits are skeletal variants that have both a genetic and non-genetic disposition. Traits from the second category have been directly correlated to activities. In this study, eight non-genetic non-metric traits were examined based upon the strength of previous research supporting their correlation with a habitual movement, as well as the goal of representing a variety of areas and muscle movements of the body. As an example, these are the three grades of a trait known as Martin's facet, which is the blurring of the lateral margin, so the side outside margin of the distal femur, as a result of habitual squatting. So you can see here, there's still a very clear margin in grade one. In grade two, it tends to blur away a little bit, and by three, the severe grade, you have total blurring of the margin. All in all, I collected data from 27 different muscle insertion sites per side, chosen from across the body, again, in order to represent a wide range of movement, and ascertain information on repetitive activities, micro and macro trauma. I also examined 12 different surfaces per side, representing the major appendicular joints for any signs of osteoarthritis. And finally, I looked for 8 different non-genetic, non-metric traits, which again were chosen based upon the strengths of previous research supporting their correlation with a habitual movement. In total, 87 non-pathological adult individuals with definite sex characteristics were examined. Age groups were divided into 4 categories: early young adult, late young adult, mature adult, and old adult. And sex and age were checked against historical records when possible. And more and more records are being confirmed, so it's kind of an ever-changing process. But the majority of the individuals, and hence my ability to have very narrow age categories. So my results. Due to the ordinal nature of the data, clearly slight to severe is rather qualitative, non-parametric statistical tests were run to check for asymmetry as well as potential correlations between each point the data was collected on and each of the categories of age, sex, and body size. To look for age differences, partial correlations were run controlling for sex and body size. Similarly, in order to look for sex differences, partial correlations were run controlling for age and body size. So rather than bore you guys to tears with endless statistical tables, I've tried to sum up my results as succinctly as possible. Early young adults are notable for having the lowest entheseal robusticity scores for any age group, while simultaneously holding 4 out of the 5 significant correlations with the stress lesions. This data supports recent studies which have suggested that stress lesions on entheses are not part of a continuous spectrum of robusticity, as was previously thought for quite a while. Nothing significant correlated with the late young adult group, while the mature adult group correlated singularly with a large number of entheseal robusticity variables from across the entire body. Notably, there are multiple correlations with adduction and lateral rotation of the leg, which I will talk about more in a minute. To look for sex differences, ossification exostoses were found to be asymmetric and correlate with age, sex, and body size. When sex and body size were controlled for, several entheses had strong correlations with older age. However, when age and body size were controlled, clear differences between the sexes were revealed. So males on the left, females on the right. Very strong correlation coefficients. Okay. These trends suggest that women were starting an activity early in life that involved excessive and often traumatic extension and flexion of the left arm. And while I am very hesitant to overinterpret these findings, I will say that these results provide potential support for the activity of cutting cheese curd with a harp. This is the traditional cheese, harp, and curd cutting method in which you literally have a giant dad and are doing this. So a lot of flexion and extension, which also lends potential support for this role as a gendered labor activity. These trends also suggest that the main difference between men and women for these specific ossification exostoses are associated with old age. The first two variables are associated with medial rotation of the right leg, while the last variable is associated with lateral rotation of the left leg, motions that would result in both feet facing in the same direction. Additionally, males held the only significant osteoarthritis correlations, and these were in the ankle joint, as well as the only significant non-metric trait, which was Poirier's facet, which is an indication of excessive extreme leg extension. So what could that mean? That's a whole lot of words, right? Honestly, I presently have no idea what could be the root cause of this pattern. I'm very open to suggestions. I've gotten some very funny ones. But clearly, there is a difference between the sexes in this general pattern of activity, and this is the pattern of activity I'm talking about. So, not necessarily with the extension being bending down like that, but something that is promoting extension. In addition to this movement. So general pattern activity is supported by all three of the methodologies that I have incorporated. So my conclusions. There are significant differences in upper and lower limb activities between the sexes, suggesting there was a division in type of activity. The strong correlations between age and most variables examined suggest an evenly divided level of activity between the sexes. And while there are these indications of differences in the kinds of activities being performed, due to the increased demand for Dutch dairy products, and therefore the need for everyone to contribute to production, the general levels of strain between the sexes were actually expected to be equivalent for men and women. So we're still seeing extreme levels of strain, just a difference in the activity patterns associated with them. Further research into historic dairy farming practices may help clarify these activity patterns. But as I had said at the beginning, we try not to overinterpret our findings and get too specific with them. So I am looking into traditional methods of cheese making. But like I said, with the curd cutting harp, I'm hesitant to try and point out the same sort of thing for the males. So the next step in my dissertation research. My further analyses include biomechanical data, specifically the cross-sectional geometric analyses of CT scans, which I have already taken of both humeri and a femur of each individual. Additionally to the individuals I've already talked about, I will be adding 36 subadults, ranging from infant to 16 years of age. The goal is to help define age ranges during which changes in activity patterns appear in life. Since biomechanical studies of activity patterns are founded upon the ways in which a bone will adapt its overall structure to changes made specifically in its load environment, the use of cross-sectional geometry may be indicative of intensification in production at Middenbeemster, while also changes in the notions of childhood and the length of this period of time in the life course are expected to be seen in changes in the cross-geometric properties of the subadult samples, thus reflecting notions of a shorter childhood, symptomatic of labor beginning earlier in life. Acknowledgements. I want to thank Stahl for helping contribute to me being able to go to the Netherlands several times, as well as my work with the Laboratory for Human Osteoarchaeology at Leiden University, the historic Hundeshop of Beemster, which is their historical society. They're doing a lot of archival research. And finally, the Orden van de Prince travel grant from the Dutch Studies Department here at Berkeley. So, anyone has any questions? I'd be happy to answer them.
Mystery. So, what are the ideas you have? You prepare a system. mysterious to us.
About the leg thing? I don't.
Nobody's, you said people have given you
people give me funny things like disco dancing.
Okay,
and it's difficult trying to, I don't want to jump too far into actual dairy farming techniques and everything until I have all of my data together, because I don't want to try and be driving my results in any one direction.
Well, I was just thinking that it may not be dairy, it may be something linked to the landscape.
Mm-hmm.
It's always started in the water, but it could be cutting peat.
Yes,
you know,
exactly.
I mean,
which
there's a
could
lot of things besides
be,
just
yeah.
taking care of the cows and milking and carrying the wheelbarrows in with the milk to the barn to produce cheese. There's
yeah.
also the water maintenance, the landscape, the
yeah,
things.
Exactly, which is why I was saying I haven't gone too far into looking at possible explanations yet, because I don't want to drive my analyses into something like only dairy thing, you know, explanations. The peat box for fuel is definitely, would have some sort of strain physically on the body, and would be something likely that all individuals participated in, and it's just part of household duties. Julie?
So you mentioned that there are canals at that time, so do they have to like take a boat or row their way to work every day?
It remains a very small area, so while aquatic transportation is definitely a part of daily life, still is in a lot of the Netherlands, I wouldn't think the water is very still.
Okay.
So I think it would be part of a movement, again, that's part of daily life, but not necessarily something so strenuous that it would leave a mark.
Okay, I thought that might, it's a, like a similar movement to the carp, so it's
exactly.
be a,
rowing.
Another part of...
They tend to do the two-handed
Oh, the two, okay.
rowing, but yeah, it's definitely something that...
Hunting.
But everything else was. And so part of looking, doing the CT scans on both humeri is to see if that's supported by the actual cross-sectional geometry of the bone. So I am hoping that the CT scans are going to provide a whole nother level of interpretations.
You were saying for the rotating and the extension of the feet, that's men primarily?
Yes. Yeah, mature adult males.
So I'm thinking about like other examples where you have kind of like labor migration among men in places like say South Africa, that's a thing that happens today. Is there any kind of evidence for like migration to industrial centers in the Netherlands? Or like during the 19th century, like you have in other parts of Europe, I think you have like journeymen is a thing where like young men go and like out and learn crafts or go to like factories.
I know what you're talking about. In Germany,
yes. Yeah, so I wonder if it's a not symmetrical thing, if it's like someone working a machine all day or something like that. Pushing
with,
a lever, like.
With both.
Or you're saying it's an asymmetrical thing? Or is
it I'm saying that the individuals are coming up with it being per individual having both significant.
Oh, so it is asymmetrical.
Yeah, it's a symmetrical, but not mirror image, like literally symmetrical.
Okay, but it is something like irregular that you wouldn't just see someone walking around. So.
Yeah, I mean, so. Normally you would expect that just walking would kind of obscure anything like that.
Yeah.
So it's definitely left leg goes out, right leg goes in, and
it
then
just
extension.
Like some kind of like industrial workers have.
Yeah, this is a proto-industrial area, at least as far as the time that the cemetery was being used.
Mm-hmm.
There were...
Which makes me think of migration.
There was an influx of German immigrants, but that was more in the 17th century, so kind of the initial population, which unfortunately the preservation of the initial population was not very good. Originally, I've been hoping to compare and look at temporal changes between the initial dairy peasantry and then the later population, but unfortunately, most of the individuals I was able to look at are from the later, the 19th century.
Yeah. What do you know about gendered activities related to dairy milking? Or in that period, because to me, like, I grew up on a dairy farm, and that position looks familiar to me as in, like, you would reach down with your right hand to, like, feel their bag, and then you might milk them. You know, so that, to me, looks like I've seen that, like, picking up milk buckets and picking things up.
Yeah, like I said.
So I wonder, like, how, like, the actual milking, because I assume they're also milking cows.
Yeah, and I also have seen...
It looks,
you know, as part of my research is watching
eating
traditional cheese making and dairy farm running on YouTube and things, which is really funny. And like I said, I'm hesitant to get too far into it because I don't want to overinterpret one of the main criticisms of activity pattern analyses is overinterpretation of the results. So I really haven't delved into any of that. I wanted to get through my CT data first and kind of give myself as neutral as possible of an approach to the results of my data.
Yeah.
But yeah, I believe me, Katie, I plan on coming and talking to you about
field
your
trip.
Experiences
with
your
field trip.
Is there anything else?
Yeah.
Do they know if the canals freeze in the winter?
They do. Some of them do, yeah. And definitely up in northern Holland.